Welcome to the Blue Ridge Baptist Church YouTube channel. It's brought to you by the folks here at Blue Ridge Baptist Church, and we pray you receive a special blessing while spending the time here with us. And to God be the glory.
We were singing earlier, "How Great Thou Art," or someone was playing it, and we were trying to sing it with them. And truly, the Lord is great, is he not? This song says, "How great that it is to serve a living God." I listened as a man cried out to his God of wood and stone, and it broke my heart to see all the tears that he shed alone, for I knew that it was hopeless, that he would not an answer from the God he served that could not hear nor see. So I fell down on my knees to pray, like so many times before, and I boldly asked my God, hear my prayer once more. And it seemed that the heavens just opened up, and I could hear him say, "Yes, my child, I can hear you. What do you need today?"
Bless the Lord that he's the living God. I am thankful for that. And I'm glad you can have a personal relationship with him. I'm glad of that. I'm glad I remember the night that he moved into my heart. And I'm grateful that because of that, I have a desire and a want to please him, want to serve him. And I'm thankful that I can be in his service. Now, I hope I'm getting charged right here. Oh, don't y'all? It's terrible not to have a charged up preacher. And so I hope I'm getting charged. Amen. He said I could preach a long time. And so thank the Lord for that. Well, it's good to be here, and I praise God for it. I'm grateful you're here. If you have your Bibles, We're going to go over to the book of 1 Corinthians for just a moment, and also the book of Acts, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and also Acts chapter number 2, and I'd like to read those two passages of Scripture this morning, and the Lord being our helper, preach for a little while from these passages. Now, I was starting to say just a minute ago, the Lord is real and He's personal. And if your Lord is not real and He's not personal, then I would shuck Him and find one that was real. Isn't that right? I mean, if He won't do you no good, and you know, I look at a lot of folks and their God ain't doing them a whole lot of good. If He ain't gonna do you no good, I wouldn't necessarily want to waste my time with Him. Isn't that true? But if there's a God in heaven, and that God in heaven would send His Son to die for me, and then would say that if I would believe in Him and trust Him, He would come into my heart, make a difference in my life, change me, so that the eyes of the Lord, as our Sunday school said this morning, the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous and His ears are open unto their prayers, I'd say that's the kind of God I want. And I want one that when He moved in, I knew He moved in. In case He moves out, I would know He moved in, you know. If He ever moved out, I'd sure want to be aware of that. Wouldn't you? Now, I'm glad He moved in to stay, and I appreciate that. But I'm saying to you this, I'm glad God is real. And I bless Him for it. And there was a marriage in my soul when Jesus saved me. There was a marriage took place in my soul when Jesus saved me. And I'm so grateful and thankful for that. Now, notice if you will, in 1 Corinthians chapter number 2, beginning there at verse, well, I would love to read the entire chapter, but I'm not. Verse number 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Then Acts chapter number 2, in verse 22, ye men of Israel, hear these words, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by Him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, have ye taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that He should be holden of it. Peter says to them that it was Jesus whom they had crucified. They have taken by wicked hands and crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up from the dead. Now I want to speak to you this morning on a subject that truthfully I have borrowed the title. And I borrowed the title from one of your well-known, I don't know if they're sitcoms or if they're just humorous movies. I don't know, but 30-minute programs, I don't know what you call them. But I'm sure you're familiar with it. You know, we was raised on Andy Griffith. You know, most all of us were raised on Andy Griffith. And we certainly enjoy Andy Griffith.
But there was another one that was right on the heels of Andy Griffin, and our boys see it now quite frequently when we have a few minutes to get ready and stuff like that. But do y'all remember Gomer Pyle? Do y'all remember him, Gomer Pyle? And one of the things Gomer Pyle always, you know, come up, Sergeant Carter, boy, it's good to have these cadets with us because sooner or later they'll have a Sergeant Carter, you know. But Gomer Pyle would always, you know, with Sergeant Pyle, they had that relationship, that kind of camaraderie. And Sergeant Carter was always trying to get rid of Gomer, shove him off somewhere else. And then it would work around that Gomer would always come back, and he'd come back and he'd say something like, "Surprise, surprise, surprise." Y'all remember that? Well, that's what I want to talk about this morning. Surprise, surprise, surprise. If they had known it, they would not have crucified the Prince of Glory. If they had known it. Now in the book of 1 Corinthians here in chapter number 2, the opening verses of this chapter contain some tremendous truths about preaching. Some have the idea that preaching is something that you just have to do if you're religious and you got to go to church, you've got to hear preaching. But I want to say to you, God has something very important to say to us and to this world through preaching. Now there are all kinds of different measurements and all kinds of different standards as to what is good preaching and what is not good preaching. I want to say after these almost 50 years, I've been measured about every way you can be measured in the matter of preaching. And so I'm really not concerned as much about being a good preacher as I am about being a faithful preacher. And but there's all kinds of standards. Some of you have in your mind what is a good preacher and what is not a good preacher. But in the Bible here, I'm reminded of the motive of preaching. There in those first few verses, the Apostle Paul said, "I didn't come to you with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." And dear friend, that is the motive of preaching. It is to declare Jesus Christ. He says, "I was with you in weakness, in fear, in much trembling. My speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." The Apostle Paul says, my whole motive in preaching is not to build a name for myself. It is not to propagate an idea that I am so interested in. My whole motive of preaching is to preach Jesus Christ crucified to you, that He's the only way of life, and that's for your good and not for your hurt. I want to say to you, the motive of preaching, the ministry, dear friend, is about people. And we ought to be, as children of God, helping people, reaching out to bring to them the gospel of truth. Verse number 2, he says, "The message that I have to bring is Christ." And he says, "I'm determined not to know anything among you but Jesus Christ. I'm resolved. I am purposed to have nothing to present to you but Christ." Now, I want to say this, and I hope I can say it with all sincerity of heart, that the real message of preaching is to point people to Jesus. We're so often in emphasizing the problem, the sickness, the sin, instead of the cure, the Savior, the physician. And I want to say, dear friend, I know humanity's sick. I know men are in trouble. I realize that. But friend, the cure and the only cure and the remedy and the only remedy for this sin-cursed world is Jesus Christ. He's the only remedy that mamas have, that daddies have. He's the only remedy that children have, teenagers have, is Jesus Christ. But thank God He is the remedy. He's the balm in Gilead. He's the one that can take and do more for you in 3 seconds than what a lifetime with other folks can do. I'm glad of that. And He's the only one that has forgiveness of sin in His message. Thank the Lord for that. Then again, in these few verses right here, you can't help but to see the manner of preaching. He has come, the Apostle Paul says, not with enticing words, but in demonstration or display, power, not in enticing words, but in the dynamite of the gospel. Now I'm glad, thank God, it's not wrapped up in talent, it's not wrapped up in ability, it's not wrapped up in education, but it's all in the touch of God upon the truth of His Word. God honors that, and I bless Him for that, and that's what draws our heart towards the Lord. And so I know that the motive and the message and the manner of preaching, as it's given right here, are so important. But the Bible says that if they had known, if they had just known all there was to know about it in verse number 8, it said they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. I was thinking about that, and in these verses, the idea, of course, is that had their eyes been opened, there's a great mystery involved in this thing. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. They didn't see it. They couldn't comprehend it. They could not digest the truth that there was a Savior that would die for them. It's a hidden mystery, the hidden wisdom of God that God preordained, and they just couldn't see it. They did not realize that God had a purpose. God had a purpose. And dear friend, what a tremendous purpose that was. This wonderful mystery ordained before the world ever was. God had a plan before this world concerning the preaching of the gospel of His darling Son. In that plan of God or purpose of God, I want to say that God declares to us, and it is a mystery, God had a desire to be loved, and He devised a plan whereby He could love, serve, appreciate. We could love, serve, and appreciate and glorify Him. And apart from that plan, dear friend, man was destined to eternity apart from God. But thank God He had a plan. He's a designer. He designed it of Himself and by Himself. The purpose of God. And it was a mystery and is a mystery until a person sees Christ. Then it begins to open up to your heart ever so newly. Let me say another word concerning if they had known. You know, if they had just known something about the purpose of God, or even the fact that God... You know, there are words in the Bible that some people get stumped on. I mean, they just get, you can't help it. And a thoughtful consideration of different words in the Bible, just sometimes we get people, you know, unnerved. Like the idea of the word ordained, or the word predestinate, or the word foreordained. You know, those kind of words put us in touch with the God of providence. Most folks just want to say things just happen, you know, or they're lucky, or vice, you know what I'm saying. But we're serving a God of divine providence. And dear friend, I want to say to you, had they known about it, He's the God that orchestrates. He's the God that works behind the scenes to bring to pass everything that is. You take Abraham in the Bible. I'm thankful that Abraham, there was a ram caught up there in the thicket, and Abraham did not have to take the life of Isaac there on that altar. I'm glad Eliezer, when he took that 500-mile journey over there to get a bride for Isaac, there was a Rebekah that was waiting for him. I'm glad, dear friend, that Joseph, whenever he descended down into that pit, was raised up and spent those years away from his father. All the while, thank God, Joseph was headed to a throne, and God was making that for him. He's a God of providence. I'm thankful for men like Moses, whose story tells us that though Moses was a little baby, pushed off in a bulrush basket into the river, thank God there was a woman come by that way that happened to be the daughter of the Pharaoh. And dear friend, that little tear turned her face towards that little boy. And Moses was raised in the household of Pharaoh, became the deliverer of Israel. I'm thankful for stories like Esther's story, who during that captivity in the land of Persia, God had raised her up for a purpose. I'm thankful for that. That's providence. There's nowhere that this is more evident than at Calvary. The providence of God meets and shakes hands with the purposes of God, and there we see the mystery unfold. I've often thought about those folks around Calvary, puppets dangling and dancing according to the movements of sovereign hands, connected by the strings of God's purpose. We call it providence. They did not know anything about the providence of God. Had they known it, things might have been different. Then again, I'm thinking this, that they didn't know anything about God's promises. Verse 2 says, "For I've determined to know nothing among you but Jesus Christ and Him crucified." Verse number 7 says, "And we speak the wisdom of God, a hidden wisdom that God ordained before the world was." I want to say to you, dear friend, this idea of a mystery is not a puzzle. It's not a puzzle. Oh, no. It's not something magical. Oh, no, no. It's that which cannot be known except by divine revelation. It's a mystery. It's something that's hidden. Nobody could understand it. Satan couldn't even understand it. You know, we think Satan is somebody that knows everything, but that's not so. He did not know about this great mystery right here. Oh, he knew that something might happen one day, but he had no idea what it was. That's why all the way through the history of the Old Testament and through the New, he kept trying to snuff out the divine seed of God. He just didn't know how it was going to come. And I want to say, he knew that the seed was on the way. That is in Genesis 3 and verse number 15. He knew that the seed of woman was going to one day bruise his head. But dear friend, he didn't know how it was going to happen. The conflict began. The promise of the Son was going to destroy Satan. And all the way through that Old Testament, friend, he would speculate, who's he going to be? Where is he coming from? In fact, he said he shed the blood of Abel, thinking that maybe Abel was going to be it. He tried to contaminate the seed of Israel, knowing that if the seed of Israel was contaminated, then of course he could not come by Israel. He tried to destroy that nation all the way through. Why? Because there was a conflict there, and he did not know how it was going to come out. At Calvary, the devil and all of his hordes, all those demons of hell, shouted, "Victory! Victory! Victory!" John had pointed to Christ in the New Testament and said, "There's the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." And the devil said, "If I can get him on that cross, that'll be the end of it." And brother, I want to say to you that wicked men have oftentimes celebrated the crucifixion of Christ, and around the cross, religion, dear friend, was rejoicing, and the demons were dancing, and they were saying, "Victory! Victory! Victory!" And all the while, the angels of glory were were saying, surprise, surprise, surprise. If they had known it, they would not have crucified Christ. Now, I want to tell you the first, I got a three little surprises, all right? The first surprise that they discovered about Calvary is this. They did not understand that God did have a plan of redemption. God did have a plan of redemption. Now, wicked men have always been the instruments of Satan to unknowingly accomplish the will of God. They did not know that they were accomplishing the will of God, but these wicked men, these wicked princes of the country, they crucified the Son of Glory. They did not know that they were doing the will of God. We would have shook our heads and we would have said, oh, no, that cannot be the will of God. Have you ever thought about the devil, Satan, when he tempted men? He tempted man in order to hurt God. That's why he did it. He did it in order to hurt God. Man's made in the image of God. Man set in a garden, the paradise of God. Man is ruling and tending to that garden, and boy, everything is doing well. Man is clothed, he's robed, he's arrayed with purity and honor and innocence and glory. That's what man was robed with. And in order to hurt man, Satan says, if I can hurt God, I'll hurt God by hurting man. I'll destroy God's masterpiece. I'll destroy man. I'll make man bleed. And that's what the temptation was about. It was to make man reject God, turn from God's commandment, and make God bleed. Or make man to bleed. And Satan did that. He tempted man. He did not know that God had ordained a redeemer. He did not know that there was a redemption plan in the mind and heart of God, and that man's healing was going to be performed or going to come to pass through the bleeding stripes of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to say to you, though the devil did deceive man, and though man stepped into that sin and death passed upon all men, man did bleed. Dear friend, I want to say, though man had an incurable wound, thank God, God redeemed man through the bleeding stripes of our darling Savior. And that blood that he shed, dear friend, at Calvary's cross completed the redemptive plan of God. Satan didn't know about it. Had he known about it, it would have never come to pass. Had the wicked princes of this world known about it, they would have never crucified the Son of God. Calvary was God's plan. It wasn't the devil's plan. It wasn't the devil's plan. Calvary wasn't an accident. It wasn't an afterthought. It wasn't an unforeseen happenstance. Oh, no. Calvary was a purposed thing. It was something that was predestined to happen. It was an event that would change all of eternity. Calvary, the sinner is reconciled unto God. Justification becomes a reality. Redemption becomes man's portion. There's a reception. That which was lost has now been found, thank God, and a recovery. I want to say to you, Calvary was not an accident. Had they known that redemption was going to be wrapped up in the blood of the Savior, they would not have crucified the Son of God. I want to say a second thing. Not only did they not understand that Calvary was God's plan for the redemption of man, but also they did not understand that Calvary, the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ would really be the path to their ruin. I mean by that this. Pilate didn't know what it was about. He took and tried to wash his hands of the innocent blood. He did not realize that the death of this Christ was going to seal his doom forever. And I don't think the religious, the Jewish people understood that whenever they delivered Christ up, I don't think they understood altogether that when he died, it was going to seal their doom. I don't necessarily believe that mob that cried, "Crucified, crucified, crucify him." I don't believe they understood what they said when they said, "Let his blood be upon us and our children." I don't believe they understood what was going on. I don't think they understood that while they were crucifying the Son of God, they were sealing their own doom. Dear friend, they knew that D-Day was coming, but they didn't know when it was coming, where it was coming, or what it means. They didn't know by what means it was going to come. They did not realize that the nail that was driven in the hands of Christ were the nails in the coffin of death and of the devil. I want to say they did not realize their doom was wrapped up in the idea of the Savior dying at Calvary. Hebrew writer said in Hebrews 2 and verse number 14, "For as much then as children are partakers of the flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had power of death, that is, the devil." They did not understand that the cross work of our Lord Jesus Christ would seal death's doom and the devil's doom and the doom of those that died in their depravity. They did not realize that. One might have said, well, the devil has fallen in his own trap. And I guess that's true to a great degree. You remember Haman had laid the trap for Mordecai. And certainly he built the gallows for his enemy Mordecai. And it ended up that Haman was hanged on his own gallows. Those very gallows that he had built to slay his enemy were the gallows, dear friend, that slayed him. Dear friend, that was certainly a turn of events. But I want to say it might be more accurately to say that it was not that the devil fell in his own trap, but rather that Calvary was a trap that God set for the devil. That might be a more accurate way of saying it. The devil stepped into his own trap at Calvary. He said, if I can just get him up there on that cross, that'll be the end of it. But dear friend, that wasn't the end of it. Oh no. I was thinking about some years ago, I read a poem, and I think I've heard it a couple of times since then, but it was a poem dealing with death, and it went something like this. It said, "Father Time met old King Death." Have you ever heard it? "Father Time heard old King Death sitting by a tomb. Hello, old friend. I guess you're here to seal someone else's doom." "You might say that," sly Death replied, and a smile lit upon his face. "Inside lies that Jesus man who said that he'd come to save the race. And you, Time, why are you stopping here? Don't you have things to do? Oh, I come each day to draw the veil and let the morning come through. Say, why are you watching o'er just one grave with all your vast domain? Looks like you'd be rambling around, smiting folks with pain. Well, this one's something special. He challenged me, they say. Said he'd rest here just 3 days and get up and then walk right away. Now, I'm the conqueror, you know. They don't talk up to me. When I step in to cut them down, it's for all eternity. I can sure testify to that, responded Father Time. I ain't seen one shake off the dust since you was in your prime. Well, I've got to other things to do. I must be on my way. I'll see you when I come again to make another day. Mr. Time went on up the hill and bid the sun to rise and left death standing by the tomb, looking strong and looking wise. The next day Time passed by again. How are things? He queried. Kind of quiet, Death replied. I'm starting to get a little worried. I won't be here when you come by about this time tomorrow. I'll be on my way, spreading grief, sorrow. Now, Father Time was quite surprised when he came back to see Death a quivering on the ground and in frightful agony. His eyes were set. His throat was large. His clothes in disarray. It wasn't difficult to see that old Death had met its day. What happened, Death? Said Father Time. What makes you look so bad? I've never seen you look this way. You seem so scared, sad. Death pulled himself up on a rock, looking sick and humble, hung his head and wrung his hands. Time could hear him mumble. I was sitting here before the dawn, about to take a stroll, when all at once this whole wide world began to rock and roll. That rolling stone jumped off the door and skipped on down the hill. And everything drew dark and quiet. It seemed the whole world stood still. He came out, got a hold of me, threw me to the ground, put his foot on my neck and stripped me of my crown. Angels came and talked with him, then glistened like the sun. He said, the plan's all finished now. Redemption is all done. As they passed the garden gate, I heard them say just then, he said, to free the captive, give gifts to men. Time and Death met once more again off yonder by the gate. It's good to see you, said old Time. I've been wondering about your fate. I'm just a lowly servant now. There's little time to roam. Just think I'll push this old gate wide open. My job now is to help the saints get home. I want to say to you, they didn't know that Calvary was the path to their ruin. Death would die. I'm going to say to you, dear precious friend of mine, what a wonderful thing it is that you and I, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we're headed to the other side, and death does not hold fear for us, and the devil does not hold a reign over us as he did. Calvary, Jesus crushed the head of the serpent. I want to say to you, thank God. Romans chapter 16 said, grace and peace shall, God, the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. I was reading that passage one day and I got to think about the fact that, you know, really head busting runs in our family. It really does. We'll bruise the head of Satan every time we're in obedience unto God. They didn't understand that God had a plan, or they never would have crucified the Son of God. Surprise, surprise. They did not understand that when they crucified Him, that it was going to seal their doom. Surprise, surprise, surprise. Can I go on a step farther and say that they did not understand the power of the resurrection? They put him to death, but they couldn't keep him dead. Oh, friend, they thought they had seen the last of him, and death took a hold of him and wouldn't let him go, but thank God, he just kept getting up. Hallelujah. I want to say, up from the grave, he arose. Hallelujah. I want to say, he still does that. the power of the resurrection. You know, the resurrection did some things in the Bible. The resurrection activated all of the, it accomplished the redemption that God had planned for man. We are made alive through that resurrection of Jesus Christ. It was the resurrection of Christ that established the scriptures. We delivered unto you a gospel of the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ according to the scriptures. It was the death of Christ, dear friend, and the resurrection of Christ that abolished death forever. It was the resurrection of Christ that enthroned Christ at the right hand of the Father. It was the resurrection of Christ that God committed all of the judgment of this world unto Jesus Christ. The power of that resurrection. On that day of Pentecost, when Peter stood up to preach, he said to him, "You're guilty. You've taken wicked hands and crucified the Lord of glory." And then he stuck that long finger out there and pointed to them. And he says, "And he's alive, and he's going to mete out judgment if you don't come to him." They were pricked in their hearts. They said, "Well, we thought we slayed him. We was done with him. But he got up alive, the resurrection." If they had known it, they would not have crucified the Christ. Surprise, surprise, surprise. I've moved across the country on several occasions. And I've never had anything but junk, pretty much. And I've moved in cattle trailers. I've moved on little trailers, pickup trucks, and everything else. I've moved on all kinds of stuff. And one of the things I'm very conscious about is how you got to tie things up. Now, you got to tie them up. If you don't tie them up, they're coming out. You know, that's just the way it is. I mean, you can drive any way you want to. If you don't tie them up, they're coming out. I say to myself, "Well, it'll be all right. I'm just going right over there." And so I don't throw a rope on or something on. And sure enough, come out. And I either have to leave it or stop and get it, one or the other. And depending on the circumstances and what it is, I might just leave it. I'm going to tell you what God did with this thing right here. God tied up everything at Calvary, the crucifixion and the resurrection of his darling son. He tied up the eternity at the crucifixion of his son and the resurrection of his son. He tied up your salvation and my salvation at Calvary. The only way a person will ever get saved is not by joining a church somewhere. Not by getting baptized somewhere. Not by filling out some kind of recommendation, some kind of ordinance somewhere. Not by getting to be a better man, a better woman. That ain't the way a person gets saved. The way a person gets saved is we all get saved alike. You want me to tell you how it is? It's to go to Calvary. Trust the blood of Christ who died for you to be your redemption. You get saved by trusting Christ. And that's alone. That's all it is. It's not a works of righteousness which we have done, but it's Christ and him alone. Surprise, surprise, surprise. They was awful surprised. If they had known it, they certainly wouldn't have done that. Now I want to say this to you. Now that you know it, what are you going to do with it? Now that you know that God has wrapped up everything in Jesus, what are you going to do with it? You cannot ignore it. You cannot neglect it. Once God has opened it to your mind and to your heart, you're going to have to either say yes to the Christ who died on the cross for you, or you're going to have to say no. I'll live my own life and do my own thing. And you'll perish without God. Because just as sure as that cross and that resurrection was redemption, it also sealed the faith of those that would believe not. I want to say to you this morning, I'm on that side that believes. I'm on that side that's trusted. And I want to recommend that Christ to you. What a real Christ. What a personal Christ who died for you, for me. Let's stand together. Let's bow our head for a word of prayer.
Thank you for spending the time with us at the Blue Ridge Baptist Church YouTube channel. And while you're here, please select from our playlist previous messages from both our pastor, Brother Ralph Coleman, and many other preachers and evangelists. So avail yourself of these ministers of the gospel and share with friends and family, and I know you will both find and be a blessing. And as always, from here at Blue Ridge Baptist Church, to God be the glory. Hear His voice, praise the Lord.